which is about convolution and deconvolution. Actually, we are going to speak about convolution today, and tomorrow we will speak about deconvolution, which is generally the inverse of convolution. What we are going to cover today is the definition of convolution, stating what convolution is. And then we have two cases, convolution for continuous function, which is the analytical one, which means that we are using the integration. We are conducting or carrying out integration in analytical form or symbolic form. And then we have examples on this continuous case. And then we will speak about discrete convolution, which is the case covered by the present course, because we are working on time series, which is a discrete representation of the seismic energy recorded at the instrument or at the geophones. And then also we'll have some examples on this. Then we will explain the convolution in frequency wave number domain. Do you know anything about wave number? Yes, wave number. Do you have any idea about wave number? What is the definition of frequency? What is the definition of frequency?
One divided by time.
What time? Yes. So it's one divided by the period, or more specifically, it is a number of cycles or number of complete waves in 1 second. Okay? So we call the hertz as number of complete cycles in 1 second. So if we are saying we have 1 hertz, it means we have 1 cycle. 2 hertz, we have 2 cycles, and so on. Wave number is the same for the space. So frequency for time, wave number for space. Wave number means the number of complete wavelengths in unit length. Okay? We have unit length, say meter. If the wavelength is 1 meter, so I have one wave number equal 1. It's, if it's 0.5 meter, so I have 2, and so on. In Fourier transform, we usually transform from time domain to frequency domain. Also in Fourier transform, we transform spatially from space domain, from XYZ domain to wave number domain, wave number in X direction, wave number in Y direction, and wave number in Z direction. Then we will end our discussion about the application in seismic processing, which is the subject of this course. Before we proceed to definition, I would like to start with some introduction. We have the real world and we have the ideal world. In physics, generally, and including geophysics, we usually deal with ideal world, which means in geophysics, for example, I suppose that the layer is of constant velocity, can be represented as homogeneous velocity, isotropic, and of course you know what's the meaning or what's the difference between homogeneous and isotropic. In case for those who do not remember or do not know, homogeneous means at any place, at any spatial location of the layer, the velocity is the same. Isotropism depends on the direction. At any direction, the velocity is the same. So if I'm measuring the waves that propagate vertically, the angle is 90 degrees relative to the interface. This is direction. And if I measure the velocity in horizontal direction, if the two velocities in vertical direction and horizontal direction, for example, are equal, so I may say it's isotropic medium. This is the real world. And usually we begin or we do our study here for undergraduate and even for postgraduate with the ideal world, starting from ideal world. And then we move to real world. In real world, you never find such homogeneity or even such isotropism. For example, yeah, you saw the something like mica. You saw a sample of mica, mineral mica, or schist. You saw these samples? Mica is sheets. So these sheets actually mean that the physical processes across is not the same as alone. So, which means it's not homogeneous. It's not isotropic. Other case, if you, for example, went to the field and look at outcrop of certain, say, sandstone layer, you will find places where sandstone is contaminated with some shale, some places with coarse grain, some places with fine grain. This change result in a change in physical properties and also result in change in the velocity of the layer with the space. So we suppose here at the ideal world something, and when we go to the real world we have to face that the ideal is not the case. So we want to make something that moderate or some accommodate this difference by introducing some non-homogeneity, some non-isotropism to our problem when dealing. Okay. I just defined this in my speech. If I'm measuring certain physical property with distance, with angles like this, and find out that the physical property is equal for all directions, so this is isotropism. If, for example, we have the velocity is larger at certain direction and smaller at another one, it's anisotropism or anisotropic behavior of the medium. Okay? So when we go to real world, we face some complicated case, some complicated fields. It's not that smart and that simple assumptions. So we start to introduce some random noise to imitate the real world and to cope or to deal with this real case. And this is done usually or partially, I mean, by convolution and deconvolution. Because convolution and deconvolution is used for blending. You know the blender in your kitchen?
Yeah.
You put apple, you put kiwi, you put strawberry, and blend. I don't know the result will be good or not, but then you drink the result. So we are putting some effects from other factors in our problem, and then blend these factors together to produce the seismic section or to produce the seismic trace. Also, we have to keep in mind that one important definition that the earth acts as a filter, and specifically the earth act as low pass filter. So when seismic energy pass through the earth, the high frequency is filtered and the low frequency is passed. So I'm expecting at longer distances to have much lower frequency than at shorter distances. You have to keep this in your mind, because we are going to use this many in our course. Okay, so convolution may be used for filtering, and deconvolution may be used for reverse filtering. So what is the definition of convolution? A convolution is an integral that expresses the amount of overlap of one function as it is shifted over another function. Two functions is the convolution we'll see now. It's shifting the function, and then you integrate this shift again to get the overlap between these two ones. It therefore blends one function with another, like kiwi or apple and strawberry. For example, in synthesis imaging, the measured dirty map, the map we observe, okay, is a result of the convolution of the true clean map, the true one, plus the dirty beam, or the noises that introduced to the picture due to the effects of the beam used for making this map. Mathematically, convolution is expressed as F convolved with G in time domain equal integration from 0 to T F tau. Here tau is dummy argument we are going to use to reverse the order of the function, times G T minus tau D tau. Okay, so this is a representation, or this is a mathematical representation of convolution operation. In the last equation, we were speaking about finite convolution, but actually convolution is more often taken over in finite range from minus infinity to plus infinity. This means that a convolution is an integral of function gt with a flip. This function flipped, okay, like one looking in the mirror, like mirror image of the view of the function f of t, or vice versa. Now we have an example showing the convolution. We have two boxcar functions. Yes. This one is Philip. Of course, these two functions are symmetric. So the inverse or the flip is the same as the original one. And then the function, one of the function is shifted, and then it shifts until it comes here to overlap with the other one. So the green line here represents the convolution of the function f of x or f of t with the function g. Okay? This green line represents the convolution in the present case. We have another example for Gaussian. This is Gaussian function. Gaussian function, also known as normal distribution function. We have also, and it's also symmetric function. One is flipped and then it shifts. So you see this dashed curve represents the amount of overlap. This dashed curve here represents the amount of overlap between the two functions as we shift in time or space. So the function is shift either in time or space. We have also another example. Suppose I have function gx of this form, and I want to make or to convolve f of x with g of x. This at x equal 2, and this at x equal 3, and this one at x equal 4. And we see this is the place of the function f of g of x after it's actually they didn't flip here, but they shift only, and this is the result at this point. And we sum these values together and both at this point here at 2, and then at 4, 3, and then 4, 4. The result will be this one. So this is the convolution between these two functions, g of x and f of x. Convolution integral can be also illustrated as weighted summation of shifted copies of certain function. So at each point we have copy of this function, and this one is weighted multiplied by weights of coefficient from the other one and then summed. So it is weighted summation of shifted copies of certain function, where the weighting coefficients of each copy is given by the second function. We have to keep in mind also that convolution can be used for functions in time domain, frequency domain, and space, or even 3D space. So convolution is used for seismic in time domain, and for potential field in space, and also used for digital image processing, also for space. Now we move to the discrete domain. In discrete, as we speak about this before, as I told you before, we are converting from continuous function to discrete function by the sampling, which will be the next topic of our class. We move from continuous to discrete, and then it's important that all our seismic data processing scheme will be carried out on discrete data or discrete time series. Okay? So, what's the steps here for discrete domain? The first step is to flip or reverse one of the digital functions. We have two digital functions in time series sense. One of them is flipped or reversed. Then shift it along the time axis by one sample. I shift the flipped one through the time, along the time axis, one sample at a time. Then multiply the corresponding values of the two digital functions. When I have overlap between the two digital functions, I multiply each respective pairs of amplitude, and then I summate the products from step two, three to get 1.4 of the digital convolution. And finally, I repeat this step again to obtain the digital for all times that the function overlap. This is an example showing what we have. We need to, or we want to convolve two time series or two discrete function, f of n, which is represented by 1, 2, 3, 4. Here, this is the function, discrete 1, 1, 2, and 3, and 4. With another function, h of n, which is 1 and minus 1. Here is 1, and here is minus 1. The first step is to reverse h. Here is hk, so we reverse this to h minus k. The function is reversed. The sample that was here, now it's here. So if you see this, the mirror image, this is the flip of the function. Here's the function. We say the function here is flipped. Then we shift. Shift means the function will move along the time axis. So say this as n equals 0. Okay. Of course, before n equals 0 or before this point, you will find that this function will be in front of zero value of the other function. So the multiplication by zero, either here or there, will become zero, and the summation will be zero. So we start from here. At this point, at n equals zero, which is the start of our convolution, we have two samples at the same point, and the other is multiplied by values of zero. So here I will, for this case, we have only one sample, so I will multiply one by one. So the result is one. Then we shift another step. In this case, I have these two samples in common. So I multiply minus 1 by 1. The result is minus 1. And then multiplying 2 by 1, the result is 2. Then I sum the multiplication. So it's 2 minus 1. The result is 1. So the second point is 1. So I move another step. Here it's supposed to be zeros, and here it's zero. So we are not going to worry about these values. So we are also here interested in this part, where here we have 2 times minus 1, it's minus 2, and 3 times 1, it's 3, and then the result is 1. Okay? And so forth. And here we arrive at 3 times 1, so it's minus 3, and 4 times 1, it's also 1. And finally, the final result is that the convolution of f of n, the function of amplitude or series of amplitude 1, 2, 3, 4, with the another discrete function of amplitude 1 and minus 1, and keeping to mind that we have to, the both signals must be of the same sampling interval. Okay? So the result is g of n 1, 1, 1, 1, minus 4. Okay? So one important question. Now I start with function with a dimension or length 4, and another function with a dimension of length 2. What is the dimension or the length of the resulted convolution? The length of the resulted convolution equal the length of the first signal plus the length of the second signal minus 1. That's why we have Gn of length equal 5. As you see, the convolution is in time domain is complicated. Even where we're working or have example with just two functions of length 4 and length 2, and we made some complicated processes or operations. We multiply and then we sum. When we are going to use realistic data, for example, the seismograph, outside, it records the samples of 4,096 for one trace. So if you are going to use 40,096 samples and convolve with another 4,096 sample, the operation will be very complicated and very hard and time consuming for computation, even with computer. Thus, we use the theory that, with the convolution theorem and Fourier transform, that the convolution of two functions in time or space domain equals the multiplication of the two function element by element or point by point in the frequency domain. The convolution f of x and g of x equals the multiplication of f u times g u, where f of u is the Fourier transform of f of x, and g of u is the Fourier transform of g of x. And this is the most powerful point. Okay, this is the most powerful point, because when dealing with, say, seismic section with, say, 100 of geophones or 100 of traces, and these traces is of length thousands of samples, so if I'm going to carry out convolution or filtering, the operation will take so long time. And it actually, in our day work in hydrocarbon or oil companies, we time and the computational time or cost is very important. And you have to give the board some information at the time. After conducting, say, seismic reflection data and carrying out magnetic, gravity, well logging, and so, and also geochemical analysis, at some time, the board of the company needs to take decision, either to go on in the work or to stop. You know, it's not because you find some hydrocarbon traces in some place, okay, bring the machines, bring the factories, and come exploit here. No, it's not the case. So we are going, the company of the board use all the information from seismic and from well logging and from other means to take decision whether to continue or to stop, because the industry is cost effective. We have to get money. If it is not, it will not produce welfare to the company, okay, we'll stop and we'll say we are not going to exploit this for the time. Maybe after some time when oil prices increase, maybe I will return to this area and exploit, but for the time, it's not exploitable. So at that time, the board is waiting and calling you, please tell us what to do, what's the figure, what's the situation you see, and then you are saying, wait, I'm doing convolution. Wait, I'm doing convolution. No, you are be fired. Okay, we don't need this. So, to save time consumption, we actually carry out convolution in frequency domain, not in time domain, because it's only multiplication point by point, point by point, and so where I have the result. Then all what I have to do is to make the inverse Fourier transform to restore the data to time domain again. But this theory means that the multiplication in time or space domain equal to convolution in frequency domain, and the convolution in time domain or space domain equal to multiplication in time or wave number, in frequency or wave number domain. Now, what are the steps for convolution in frequency domain? I have three main steps. The first one is to compute the Fourier transform of the first function, and then the Fourier transform of the second function. Then I multiply the Fourier transform of both function point by point. You know, the Fourier transform, as we said before, it's amplitude versus frequency. So at each frequency point, I multiply this value together. The result of multiplication point by point will be the frequency domain representation of convolution. To get the convolution in time domain, I have to compute the inverse Fourier transform to get this formula. I can also apply not only one-dimensional convolution, but also I can apply two-dimensional convolution. And this is another point that why I should use Fourier transform, because for two-dimension, the situation is more complicated, and it's very hard to estimate this one in time or space domain. So the best practice will be to carry out this case in frequency or wave number domain. Now we have an example of from digital processing, from digital image processing. So this is the actual image, very clear, and it is, of course, you know the image is composed of what the so-called pixels. Pixels. Yeah, and the pixel is a point in the screen. This screen is like matrix, it's composed of pixels. In your digital camera, you see it's 3 megapixels, 5 megapixel, like Lumia is 41 megapixel. So what does this mean? It means that in each inch square, there is, say, 3 million points. So as this point increase, the resolution and detail increase. Okay? So they use this for intelligence and so to photocopy somebody from. There is some technology now called GigaBand. And this GigaBand, you can go to internet and look for the site. Maybe they use tower or something and have photo for, say, Penang. And this is gigapixel. It's not like what we are saying for 440, it's by gigapixel. So you can increase or focus, and you see some details. Maybe you see this man was stealing something, and this man was putting some this and so on situation. So it's very clear, and this could be used either for good or for bad. Okay. So the one to the right is the Fourier transform or Laplace transform of the original photo. And then we have another image. This image is only white point in the center. The Fourier or Laplace transform has this form. Then when convolving these two spectrums, we get this one. This is the result of convolution between the image, the original image, and this function. The result, when returned back to space domain, we have what we call blurred image. Okay, it's something like be used for playing with the image, putting filtering, shielding, removing some details, and maybe, for example, to try to define, for example, edges in the image, like boundaries of this apple, and so on, boundaries of the dish, and so this edge detection. So we sometimes use such thing in our remote sensing to determine edges, and also we use this for GPR also to determine structure or to enhance the image of the subsurface. There are some characteristics of convolutions. These characteristics are: the convolution is commutative, which means convolving function f with function g is equal or the same as convolving function g with function f. So either flipping f and g shifting and do convolution, or flipping G and do convolution, the result is the same. This is what's meant by commutativity. The other point is the associativity, that suppose we have three functions, F, G, and H. These three functions, I can convolve, say, J and H, and then convolve the result with F. It is equal to or equivalent to convolving F and G, and then convolve the result with H. That's what's mean by associativity. It's distributive or distributivity. Suppose I have two functions, three functions, F, G, and H. Distributive means if I convolve it, the function F, with the summation of the other two functions, G and H, it is equivalent to convolving F and G plus convolving F and H. We have also associativity with the scalar multiplication. Here, A is a scalar, so multiplying a scalar with a convolution of two functions F and G equal to the function F multiplied by scalar F and then convolve it with the function G, and also equal to the function F convolved with the multiplication of the scalar A with the function G, where the scalar A is any real or complex number. Is there any problem here? The differentiation rule. The differentiation of the convolution of two functions F and G equal the differentiation of F convolved with G, or the convolution of F with the differentiation of G. Here, the letter or the term df denotes derivative of F, or in discrete case, it is the difference. You know, we have pair, which is integration and differentiation. Integration, as we said earlier, it's summation. It's actually a summation multiplied by the increment. Here, the differentiation is the difference between two successive points in the series divided by the increment. So if I give you time series with sample interval delta t and asking you to differentiate, it means that you will take two successive points, every two successive points, and you estimate the difference and divide by delta t, or the sample interval, for all points. Okay? Now, we are going to speak about applications. So convolution is applicable in many fields. The first one in statistics. It can be seen as weighted moving average, and also it is in probability distribution. It is the convolution if you have two random variables, say these two random variables, say the weight of this hand specimen. If I take this hand specimen and weigh it on a balance, so say I made this operation for 100 times, what I end up with? About 100 different measurements for the mass. Okay? Due to many reasons. There is instrument error, there is human error, there are a change in tidal change, for example, and some many factors. So this change, I can call this as random change in measurements. Like you carried out an experiment for estimating the acceleration due to gravity, or you didn't in physics lab? Yes. So I guess, or I believe that all of you, no two of you agreed on certain value. So if I have 20 person in front of me, I may have 21 value for the estimated gravity, acceleration due to gravity. Why this occur due to, for example, change in room temperature, problem in the instrument that occur during your observation, due to your human error. You know, measuring, it depends on how accurate I am. So some are very accurate and some are not accurate. They do not give the interest. They are give the focus to get so correct data. So there are many errors that may enter that makes the variation of the masses or our measurements to differ. This is called random variable. This random variable has distribution. The distribution is the number of repetition of each value. So suppose I made, say, 100 weighing for this specimen, I will have about 100 value, and these values, when used like in election, and you made classes, say from 10 to 10.1, 10.2, 10.3, and so on, you will get distribution of these measurements. So convolution looks pretty the same as the weighting average of the convolution of each distribution of two random, or the probability of two random variables. Three, in optics, we have seen this application in the previous slide. Many kinds of blur are described in by convolution. Shadow, like shadow on the table when you hold your hand between the table and a light, which is the source in this case, is a convolution of the shape of the light source that is causing the shadow and the object whose shadow is being cast. Three, similarly, in digital imaging processing, convolution filtering plays an important role in many important algorithms in edge detection and related process. Four, in linear acoustics. You know, although this is not in the heart of our lecture, but there were a big debate on the nature of light. Yes, so, I think in 19th century, they have a big debate. Some says it obeys wave physics, and some say no, it doesn't obey wave physics. And the idea or the phenomena of diffraction by gratings was introduced, they realized that light obeys wave physics, because they said, okay, sound is wave physics, and because of this, and obeying Huygens' principle, my voice reach to you, and if somebody is outside this room, and the door is open a lot, due to the Huygens principle, the voice or the sound waves propagate to other room. But they argued this doesn't occur for the light. But for small slits, we discovered that Huygens principle is Okay, it's present for light, so light also obey the wave phenomena and the laws that govern wave phenomena. In linear acoustic and echo, you know the echo? You know echo? Yes. So in horror films, see echo and then you get afraid. So echo is a convolution of the original sound with a function representing the various objects that are reflecting it. So I can use convolution in movie makers or radio plays to imitate echo and other phenomena. In artificial reverberation, digital signal processing, Bro audio, convolution is used to map the impulse response of a real room. Like if you play with your computer and you get into the software for the audio, and it will give you some options like in empty room, in theater, and in bathroom, the effect of the sound. So this is done through convolution. In electrical engineering and other disciplines, the output response of a stationary or time or space invariant linear system is a convolution of the input, which is excitation, with the system's response to an impulse or Dirac delta function. Six, in time resolved fluorescence spectroscopy, the excitation signal can be treated as a chain of delta pulses, and the measured fluorescence is a sum of exponential decay from each delta pulse. And finally, in physics, wherever there is a linear system with a superposition, again, we return to superposition. So it's one of the pillars of physics and one of the pillars of geophysics. A convolution operation makes an appearance. In seismic data processing, we have digital signal filtering. The filtering, I want to remove some frequencies that represent noise or unwanted signal. So this is a seismic record. I convolve with the filter to produce filtered record. So I use convolution to apply filter to get unwanted signal away from my data. Also, another example, it's the Earth response. Earth response, as I said before, it is a low pass filter. So the source here is explosion or vibro size. When convolved with the Earth, response of the Earth, the output would be the recorded signal. And this formula is used for carrying out the so-called synthetic seismogram. Synthetic seismogram is used for some procedure called forward modeling. So suppose I have some idea about the subsurface. I put this idea into Earth response, like reflection coefficient, for example, and then make synthetic seismograms through convolution, and then compare between the synthetic cross-section and the actual one, the observed one I obtained from the data or from observations. This is how things happen. This one represent the reflection coefficient. Here is depth, or it's equivalent to the time between interfaces. So I have positive reflection coefficient, negative reflection coefficient, and so on. This is the interfaces, and this is the reflectors. This signal represents typical wavelet for the seismic source. This represents the source. When convolving this signal with the my understanding or the model I built for the subsurface, it ends up with me with this green line, which is a convolution between these two. So here, it is the first interface. Here is the second interface, the third, the fourth, and so on. Because of this picture, it's our intention or our interest to get this seismic wavelet to become as narrow as possible, as a spike or delta function. Because if this is a delta function, the result will be the same as the original one, which means when the wavelet of the source is narrow, we have good resolution about the subsurface. As it is wide in this case, you see the resolution is not good. This is real, more realistic application. The one above is the impulse response. Impulse response means the I take delta function and apply for green function, and then I got the trace in the above panel, and the source is represented here. This one is noise free seismogram, which is the convolution between this and that. And then this is the noise. Noise, it's artificially, I can use Gauss white noise to produce random values. This noise, when added to the result, I will get realistic seismogram. So this one is a realistic seismogram. Thank you.